Hello, Lakers Nation. Sean Davis here for LakersNation.com, your home for everything Lakers. It wasn't pretty at all, and that is the best way to state this game. But as the Denver Nuggets will show you tonight, a win is a win. And yeah, but I have a really great feeling that we're gonna be really frustrated with tonight's game. Welcome in to the show from YouTube, Facebook, and Twitter. Going to be taking your questions and comments from tonight's game. Trevor was covering the game in the arena tonight. He just happened to be in Memphis tonight, so he was in the arena covering the game. So no Trevor tonight. Trevor will be back on. He's not going anywhere. Joining me tonight to fill in, excited to have my guy, Scorpios guy, hopping in with me, who is live from his hotel, dedicated to the grind. Scorpio, welcome in. Thanks for hopping on, bro.
Of course, man. It's been a while. I'm happy to be on the show. This was what's the word Trevor used earlier? The penultimate game of the season, the Peralta game of the season.
Yeah,
something like that.
Yeah. Oh man, this was a frustrating game, Sky. So much so that at one point I posted this on X at Sean_DAVI. I posted that the Lakers deserved to lose this game. This was probably, I think I posted it right around the middle of the third quarter. And I mean, luckily they were able to hold on. And I guess first things first, we could take a look at the box score and get that pulled up for you. LeBron James and Anthony Davis combined for 73 points tonight. A lot of minutes for AD. I want to say AD played the entire second half, if I recall correctly, but 36 points for AD. 14 boards, 5 assists, a block, and 2 steals. He had 4 turnovers. LeBron kind of closed things out late. 37 points for him, 9 boards, 5 assists. Rui, 14 minutes, good game from him. Only played 29 minutes, which I'm sure is something we will definitely talk about. And then Austin Reeves, 13 points, but he was in foul trouble. He had 5 fouls, so his minutes were significantly decreased tonight. But Sky, the Lakers had 19 turnovers tonight. I think that just showcases how sloppy this Lakers team was kind of from the get-go.
Yeah, I said to one of my friends when I was texting with during the game, it's the turnovers that was killing us. I can't see the box. So I'm doing this on my phone. So I don't All have right. my laptop with me, but I feel like LeBron probably had about 10 of them on his own. And yeah, LeBron that had was 8. That was 8. Okay, close to that. And that was really ultimately what killed us. We just kept giving the ball up. And, you know, it's embarrassing that we had to fight so hard, especially when you have your two top players scoring 70 plus points. And to become close to losing to a team where it's like, I consider myself a basketball sicko. And I can't name more than 4 guys that played in the Grizzlies. I can't name more. You know, Scottie Pippen, Gigi Jackson, Jordan Goodwin, Jake LaRavia. And after that, I don't know. Like, dude from 7-Eleven that balls at, you know, LA Fitness. You know, from 3 till 4:45. And my gardener, Celestino, was playing. Like, I don't know, man. I can't name all these dudes. Like, it's embarrassing.
Yeah, that is hilarious. And speaking of Gigi Jackson, he went nuts. 31 points for Gigi. Jake LaRavia, who killed the Lakers last time these two teams played, he had 28 points and 6 assists. Jordan Goodwin couldn't miss, seemingly, at the beginning of the game. He had 23 points. Scottie Pippen Jr. had 28 points. The Lakers' defense was just absolutely non-existent. And I feel like non-existent might be, you know, us being nice there, Sky, because and this has been a problem since the in-season tournament, quite frankly. And if you had told me, Sky, I think you were actually on. We actually did the in-season tournament final game together. I actually do remember that. You had told me that after that game, the Lakers would flip the script in a bad way and their offense would be elite, if you will, and their defense would completely fall off the map, I would have called you insane. And that is the land of the Lakers right now. And it's so frustrating watching this team with Anthony Davis not be able to get stops. And I get it, they're hurt, but that is no excuse to give up almost 130 points to the G League Grizzlies.
I can't help but feel bad for Anthony Davis as a whole. Like, for a guy that's taken so much unwarranted heat over the last few years, this year he's having an MVP season. He's having a Defensive Player of the Year season. He's probably, I think today was tying for his career high in games played for a season. So if he plays tomorrow, this will officially be his career high. He's just having an unbelievable season. And because the Lakers are in the shape they're in, because the overall defense is what it is, and that they're, you know, a 9-8-9-10 seed, he's not going to get any credit for that. He's not going to get any consideration for DPOY or for MVP. But I mean, you say it all the time. He's the best defender on the planet.
Yeah.
And it's very clear to see that. I mean, if you even just look at the way he alters shots, even when he's not blocking shots, mm-hmm. just the way he alters drives. You saw it tonight. Guys drive in, they see Anthony Davis, they're like, "Ooh, okay, I don't want that smoke. I'm gonna get back out here. I'm cool. I'm good out here, player." You know, like it's unbelievable. But for whatever reason, the rest of the team, what happened to that defense? That in-season tournament defense was so elite. If they can just put the two together and bring even a portion of that back with the current offense, then we'd really have a shot to do something in the playoffs.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And you do probably have to understand, like, you do need Vando back for the team defense, but yeah. And then honestly, and this is why it was super unfortunate that Anthony Davis couldn't go in their last game against Golden State. But that's why I was more willing to give him grace, because dog, he has been so reliable and so healthy this year. He's played through legitimately everything this season. So he deserved it that night, and I'm glad you brought that up. That he has been really, really, really consistent, reliable, and he's putting together an all NBA for sure caliber season. He's been phenomenal. Let's shift gears really, really quickly. And I know Sky can't see it, but we are going to take a look at the standings here really, really fast. Give you guys a quick update. So one of the things, if you're following along with this on the playback stream, as this guy tries to zoom in there, if you're following along in the playback stream, we wanted Denver to lose, because Denver losing and Minnesota plus OKC winning pushed Denver down to 3. And in a situation where the Lakers are, let's say, a nine seed and they have to win 2 games, that means your first round match will be against the 1 seed. And hypothetically speaking, if they were to advance and keep advancing, they could, extend a potential matchup with Denver to a potential Western Conference Finals matchup, instead of Denver winning, Denver staying in the 1 seed and playing Denver in round 1. Now, in terms of getting up to the 8 seed and getting a double elimination matchup, you need a couple of things to still happen. You need New Orleans to beat Golden State tonight, and you need Phoenix to beat Sacramento. If that happens, you feel really, really good heading into Sunday's matchup with New Orleans. That doesn't happen, then you don't really like your chances, because I want to say Golden State plays Utah and Sacramento plays somebody, if I recall correctly, that you're like, yeah, they're probably going to win. Yeah, Sacramento plays Portland and Golden State plays Utah. 2 games that they are almost certainly going to win. So your best shot in moving up to 8th and control your own destiny is Phoenix winning tonight against Sacramento, and New Orleans knocking off Golden State. Both teams on the second half of back-to-back there.
Yeah, that's tough. That's really tough. It's a scary situation to be in. You know, if we end up the 10 or even the 9, and you're facing a win-or-go-home situation against any of those teams, yeah. I wouldn't be comfortable facing the Warriors or the Kings or Phoenix in a 9-10 matchup. So let's just hope for the best that those games, I'm assuming those games are going to kick off pretty soon. The downside is the teams that we want to lose are both playing on their home floor tonight. So, they kind of got that advantage there, but let's just hope for the best.
Before we get to some of the super chats, do me a quick favor, guys, especially with people on YouTube. Hit that like button. Get this out to as many Laker fans as possible. Let's get a like spike. We're at 120 likes. Let's see on the stream. Can we get up to 250 likes on the stream? You guys are awesome. I know we can do it. So make sure you guys hit that like button for me. Let's get to some of these super chats here. Face Reality says, give me Scottie Pippen Jr.'s 28 points over D'Angelo Russell's garbage 4 points. No excuse. D'Lo has definitely had a rough stretch of games here recently, hasn't he, Sky?
Yeah, but that's going to happen. That's going to happen. Yeah. Unless you are an elite player, and even elite players have bad games. So I'm not mad at D'Lo. He's carried us to a couple of wins earlier on, and he's been incredible. So I have no complaints about him. You know, I mean, like he did well. He did other things. Yeah, he had, I don't know how many assists he had. Of course, I can't look at the box score or anything right now, but I feel like he had a decent amount of assists. He gave effort. And like I said, ultimately he's been phenomenal for the most part during the season. So he's due.
D'Angelo Russell had 10 assists tonight, to your point, and only 2 turnovers, which honestly I will take compared to the rest of this team for sure. So D'Lo did find other ways to contribute, like you mentioned, with the 10 assists. Akoa Doe with the super chat here says, this team is a disgrace. It deserves to be out of the playoffs. Look like a bunch of clowns out there jogging around. Playoff D'Lo right on schedule. Epping bum. Get ready to be destroyed by the Pelicans. Look, I don't have any right to talk. I was very, very frustrated with that performance through the third quarter. And that's really like the problem. That's my problem with the team. It's just like they sink and rise to the level of competition that they're playing. Like, this team can beat anybody except probably Denver. But this team can beat anybody. But they can also lose to anybody. We've seen it. They got blasted by the Nets in January or whatever it was, right? They can lose. They were in a dogfight with Washington like 2 weeks ago. like, this team can lose to anybody. But and you're going to have nights like this, and it's going to be ebbs and flows, if you will. But the hope is when it's a consistent, you know, playoff intensity atmosphere where it's a 7-game series, this team does bring it. But this team is definitely frustrating for sure.
Yeah, well, I think someone said it earlier, it's the Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde team. You know, it's complete opposites. You never know what you're going to get.
Yeah,
it's like a box of chocolates.
Oh, man. Jared says, the win is cool, I guess. I can just picture him saying it with a little shrug, too. Like,
the win is cool, I guess.
It's cool.
It's cool, I guess. It's cool.
I ain't tripping about the win.
Yeah.
Kind of sad we needed damn near 40 from Bron just to beat the 13-man short Grizzlies. Only positive for me is the Denver L. That injury report is legitimately one of the craziest things I've ever seen. Memphis's injury report heading into tonight's game, absolutely insane. Denver losing, like we already discussed, was definitely major. Speaking of LeBron, if you will, let's go to this, because this can be can go to
Superstar of the Night.
Superstar of the Night goes to the player that we thought was the best player on the floor for the Lakers tonight, if you all are new. Sky, LeBron, 37, 9-5, was clutched down the stretch, has the go-ahead layup, hit a couple of free throws late, gets the dunk after one of the Grizzlies players literally handing the ball like he's a running back. And then you have Anthony Davis, 36 points, 14 boards, 5 assists, and 3 stocks. What are we going with here for a Superstar of the Night?
Either one works, and they both should get it. I'm personally going to choose Anthony Davis because he was the destroyer of. They had no answer. They had to just load up the paint with all 5 guys and try to stop him. Anthony Davis is going to be my pick.
Since you take AD, I'm going to go Bron. The clutchness down the stretch. Hits, like I said, gets the go-ahead layup, gets a couple of defensive stops when, like, this team really couldn't get a stop later on the third. I will say this, and this did drive me crazy myself and Ryan Ward on playback. LeBron, there was a few possessive stretch with like 3 minutes or so left where it's Bron back-to-back bad threes. AD takes a bad one at the top of the key with Bron wide open. Yeah, again, that just goes back to the like focus thing where they just took the foot off the gas pedal, but they ultimately do win, and that is all that matters at the end of the day.
That end of the game, though, steal and dunk was awesome, though. And Taylor Jenkins was furious. Like, I mean, I almost don't even want to call it a steal. Like, they gave it to him.
Like,
that was like a 2K CPU steal. It was like, well, no, how did LeBron? I hit triangle. Why did he get the ball? Like, you know, like, that's not where I passed it. You know, like he just gave it right to him.
From the feed that we had on playback, it looked like Taylor Jenkins was more so pissed at the ref, but I had the same thought. I thought he was pissed at Bron for doing the reverse.
Because he dunked the late game instead
I thought he was pissed because Bron did a reverse, and then they kind of showed the angle from the Grizzlies bench where, like, Bron and Ja are kind of laughing and joking with each other, and when Taylor calls timeout, Taylor, like, haul asses down towards the other end of the floor. mad at the ref who didn't make the call.
Oh, he was trying to get a timeout. Is that why
he was mad at the at a call for Gigi Jackson? That's what I think it was. Rather, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe
he like threw his clipboard, everything.
Yeah, he was. Yeah,
that was great though. That was great. I love it. He should be heated.
DJ says, why did that have to be more difficult than it had to be? A win is a win, but that was not an inspiring victory when he projected to win by 15 and barely survived. Sigh. I feel like we should have seen this coming, I guess. As soon as Vegas said Lakers 15.5-point favorites, maybe we should have seen this one coming, Sky. Maybe. Maybe.
I don't know, man. I thought it was – at no point did I think we were going to just come in and blow them out on their home floor. But I didn't expect, Gigi Jackson to almost match his career high – and Jordan Goodwin to go out there and just be Steph Curry or at least Seth Curry, you know, and they had other dudes on the floor that were like dudes like me that like learn step backs while watching YouTube videos and stuff. Like, they're not even real NBA players and stuff, you know. Like, we should not have struggled this much to beat this team, but we did, and it is what it is. This is one of those things, you just take the W and you move on. You don't even look back, you know what I mean? Yeah, we got to win. That's it. I don't remember anything else. I just remember we won and move on to the next game. New Orleans the next day.
It is very early still. I mean, we know nowadays basketball, you can literally be up 20 with 5 minutes left and find a way to lose. But New Orleans is having a ridiculous second quarter right now. They're now up 11 in the middle of that game. It's almost halftime. So definitely something to keep an eye out on, and we are definitely happy for New Orleans to get that win. And hopefully they say, hey, you know what? We're going to lock up the sixth seed. We're going to rest all our guys on Sunday. Lakers, here's a win for you.
No way they do that, right?
No way.
They already said Brandon Ingram. They already said Brandon Ingram's coming back on Sunday.
Oh, that's right. They did say that. So never mind. Wishful thinking.
They would love to, I'm sure they would love to send us a little closer to not making the playoffs. I know they're not talking about taking our pick this year, but if it ends up being a lottery pick, I wouldn't doubt it.
Yeah. Mikel with a super chat says, if D'Lo isn't playing well when in clutch moments, I thought the pickup of Gabe over the summer was supposed to be that. D'Lo isn't hitting. Put Gabe Vincent in. Also, congrats on the Gabe Vincent 3 tonight. I think I wouldn't be surprised. I said this back. Actually, this was the conversation once Gabe got brought in, was kind of exactly that, Sky. If D'Lo isn't playing well in crunch time of a playoff game, you have an alternative option now with Gabe Vincent. Now, Gabe offensively hasn't quite played well, but he's been so good defensively. He makes a bunch of hustle plays. He finally hit a three tonight, finally. And hopefully we get, you know, playoff Gabe if the Lakers are able to ultimately crack in as a 7 or an 8 seed. But what have been your thoughts on Gabe since he's came back?
Pretty much the same. I'm very excited about what he's doing defensively, and I think he's working his way back offensively still. I don't know if, like, say in a playoff situation as he is right now, I would want to take D'Angelo Russell off the floor and put him on because it would basically be
Sure.
like another Jared Vanderbilt, where it's
Yeah.
like a guy they may just leave open on defense and double team whoever else is doing something. And if that does happen and he's in that situation, he has to knock down those shots. But as he is right now, I don't know if I would do that. But I again, like I said, defensively, I love what he's been doing, and hopefully the offense comes right on time.
Yeah. That would be absolutely awesome. Tyler K said almost lost to G Leaguers, him with the same blank expression on his face. Regardless if we score or get scored on, no screaming or emotion, nothing. Nuggets fall to the three seed at least. Yes, again, once again, Denver losing is awesome. New Orleans picking up some steam here tonight is also awesome. And yeah, I mean, already just gonna reiterate what we've said. You just got the win. Move on. I was normally I watch some of the film back after the game. I'm not even gonna touch this game. You move on to New Orleans. Oh
Gigi
man.
Jackson, man. Gigi
He's
Jackson.
a stud.
My
I
beard is
kind of
my beard is older than Gigi Jackson. Like, come on.
overthought it with Gigi last year. So I end up having him lower on my board that probably should have, but I do legitimately like Gigi. Memphis is gonna be scary next year. I hope
He's
people
great.
realize that. The West is gonna
Oh
be
God. Oh
even
yeah.
better next year. Sheesh.
Memphis and OKC next year. Man,
San
good luck
Antonio's
against
gonna take
them,
a
man.
leap. Houston's gonna get better. Like
Yeah.
the only two
New
teams that are
Orleans,
still
I'm
gonna be
sure
really bad.
will. New Orleans is going to do something. Yeah,
Yeah.
New Orleans is going to do something. They're going to make some sort of move. They'll get DeJounte Murray or something, like they'll probably trade Larry Nance Jr. in a first and get Larry and get DeJounte Murray somehow. Like something like that. They're like, here's
Sheesh.
Larry Nance Jr. and Naji Marshall, or EJ Liddell. Oh, cool, we'll take it. Like,
That's a hell of a
wow.
pull, EJ Liddell.
Yeah. Like, I told you I'm a basketball sicko, man. I know these
There we go.
rosters. Except the team that played tonight. I don't know who that is. I think that was Cole from the show Martin was playing like backup point guard.
Yeah. Alicia Green says, I was at this game too close for comfort. Yeah. I mean, it was embarrassing at times tonight. More so that third quarter. That third quarter was really like the peak of my frustration. But again, just happy they were able to survive and ultimately get the win.
Yeah.
Said Suka, a lot of angry super chats tonight, and rightfully so. I understand. I could have very easily forecasted this. We're going home next week. This team is next week, excuse me. This team is just pathetic, and I'm truly thinking of blowing it up. I'm tired of false hope, tired of incompetent coaching, tired of lazy front office, tired of half. I'm just gonna half-ass stars. There we go. I didn't want to say it. Keep it PG, but screw it. Look, so basically what I'm reading is you want the Lakers to make a like organizational overhaul and like fire the coach in the front and the GM. Like that's what I'm reading essentially.
Conflict and lazy front off there.
And this is a good conversation point actually. So I am actually glad he brought Sasuke brought this up. I am not, and let me get this completely like clear, because I tried to explain this the other night and it did not go over well. So I'm going to explain this hopefully better now. I want Darvin Ham gone, right? I do want to just start from square one there. I am not entirely confident that he is going to be gone though, unless it is a situation where the Lakers completely miss the playoffs. I'm not fully confident, and the reason being, Sky, I'm curious what your thoughts is. Somebody asked me on Twitter. Why didn't Genie fire Darvin in the middle of the season or whatever? Because there was a report, I don't remember from who, but there's a rumor or whatever that a lot of players wanted Darvin Ham gone midseason in favor for Phil Handy. And so somebody asked me, hey Sean, why didn't Genie fire him? And my response legitimately was because Genie likes him. And I wasn't saying that to like take a dig at Genie, but Genie's a loyal person to her own
I
fault
don't
at
think it's
times.
that.
You don't think it's that?
I
Okay,
don't
what
think
do you
it's
think it
that.
is?
No, this is what I think it is. I remember I don't remember if this was on a documentary or something, or I read a report. Going back to when Luke Walton was our coach, there were people in the organization that wanted him fired then.
Okay.
And Genie was against it. I don't know if you remember those reports. Like the same thing came out back then. It was like, oh, these people want him gone, but Genie is against it. And the reasoning, and this came out of Genie Buss's mouth, I think I saw this in an interview. She said, we cannot advance as an organization or something like that. I'm paraphrasing. If we keep firing and hiring new coaches all the time, we can't just keep replacing coach after coach after coach. We need to have some continuity. We need to have a guy in place that's going to be there. And I understand that thinking. And sure, it's the right thinking. The problem is we got to get the right guy. And we all thought Darvin Ham was the right guy. But, you know, almost 2 years later, we're seeing he's not the right guy. And so I do think he probably, unless we have some sort of crazy run like we did last season in the playoffs, if we end up in the conference finals again, then I think nothing short of staying, of ending up in the conference finals, probably means Darvin is gone. Like if we don't get to the conference finals or something, like it's going to take that for him to keep his job. I do think he will be gone. I just feel like there's too much moving in that direction. We've seen too much evidence that he's not ready to be a head coach. He may be an incredible head coach in the future, but he's not ready right now. And am I sure? Would I bet money he's gone this summer? No, but I do think he will be gone. And it could also be dependent on who's available though.
Yeah. And I think and that is a really, really good point you bring up, right? About how, and that is like, actually, and I don't think I've heard that. So thank you, Sky, for bringing that up. Because that is like actually a smart way to view things, right? Like you can't, like you said, keep having this revolving door of head coaches coming in and out. But because since LeBron's tenure, if you fired Darvin Ham this summer and replaced him with another head coach, that'll be LeBron's fourth head coach in what, 7 years? Because he had Luke for 1 year, Frank for three, Darvin for two. So yeah, wow. fourth coach.
Yeah.
In 7 years.
Wow.
Right. Which is not a good look. Right. But I think that comes down to another problem that I've had and I've talked about recently is I think there is something wrong with their interviewing process. Right. And their ability to identify coaching talent. And that's why if they do fire Darvin Ham, I want the Lakers to cast a wide net, like super wide net. Don't even have a connection to the Lakers wide net because Darvin still had a connection to the Lakers. And that's where I think it's
you know what I think is a strong possibility. I don't know if you remember these reports. I think they came out around the time we hired Darvin Ham. Mm-hmm. That Darvin Ham wasn't the Lakers' first choice. Juwan Howard was their first choice.
Juwan Howard turned it down. I remember that. He turned it down.
Juwan Howard was reportedly offered the job, basically said, if the job is yours, if you want it, and he wanted to stay
in Michigan because his son was there,
because of his sons. And Juwan Howard is no longer employed.
That so, I forgot about that. That's a really good point. And my answer for anybody asking me, I personally don't want Juwan Howard, but it's ironic that you bring that up because I had said a couple of weeks ago that I will bet like $2,000 or whatever, or maybe more, that if Darvin gets fired, one of the first interviews we hear about is Juwan Howard because of Pelinka. Like I will bet a large amount of money that if Darvin Ham is canned, Juwan is going to get an interview and potentially, excuse me, offer the job a lot because of what you just brought up.
He's got a lot of connections to the organization. LeBron loves him. He played with Rob Pelinka.
Yeah,
he played with LeBron. Yeah, right. And I believe he played with Rob as well, right? I to be, you know, a lot more about this than I do. I honestly couldn't tell you if Juwan Howard is a good coach, great coach, horrible coach. I do know that obviously the Lakers tried to hire him a few years ago. A year before the Lakers tried to hire him, the Celtics tried to hire him. So he must have some sort of credentials, but.
Mm-hmm.
There definitely seems to be some issues there too, but you know, but I would not be surprised if maybe Juwan Howard, there might have been a conversation already taking place, to be honest with you. Like, hey man, well, depending on how this goes, keep your phone on this summer.
Yeah. So
I also think if Monty Williams gets fired, he's an option too.
I think that's just so much money that Detroit would have to owe him to where I think he
Yeah.
gets at least another year or two. And
They
he
should give
hasn't
him at
been
least a
good.
year or two.
But
No,
that money is
but there is a lot
insane.
of smoke. There is a lot of smoke that he could be let go as well.
Yeah.
And he's another guy the Lakers wanted before Frank Vogel.
Yeah. Man,
So we'll
they
see.
got
It's
to do
going
a
to be a
better
very
job.
interesting summer. It's going to be hard though to bring LeBron James back with a coach that I mean, obviously he's going to sign regardless, I'm sure, but like with a coach that he knows maybe is not going to work, and
Yeah.
maybe they go with Phil Handy. Who knows? Maybe they just give Phil Handy the job. I don't
Maybe.
know, but
Let's get into this.
Star in your role.
Star in your role goes to the player that was the best player in their role tonight. That is not one of these stars. So we obviously are taking LeBron and Anthony Davis out of this category here. Chat, who is the star in your role for tonight's game? We got a couple of people saying Gabe. Hey, shout out Gabe Vincent. Hit a three. There we go.
My
Nobody.
man hit a three. Don't tell me nothing about Gabe Vincent. My man hit a three tonight.
In the chat said nobody.
Nobody. I don't know. Rui didn't seem like Rui had a decent game, did he? Or
Yeah.
I got to see the box score. I don't know.
Rui had 14 points, five boards. He was super efficient. Austin Reeves, he was in foul trouble, but he was efficient, played well, 13 points. He also had two blocks. Taurean Prince, 9 points. He was a plus 17 off the bench, hit three threes. Gabe Vincent, 5 points. Best plus minus on the team, by the way, plus 27 for Gabe Vincent tonight. So
Wow.
yep.
A lot of
Sky,
options.
yeah, a lot of them. You have a few different options there.
I'm going Rui.
Awesome. Rui's been fun. He's been really, really good recently.
Yeah, I love Rui.
I think one of the things with Rui that I talked about a ton recently and why this recent stretch of play for Rui has been so impressive is he's made you, and you can tell that he's made like a conscious effort to be better on the boards.
Yes.
Where the last 10, he is notoriously a bad rebounder, right? But
Yes.
the last 10 games, he's averaging in 32 minutes of action, 18 points a game on 56, 46, and 78 splits. 56% from the field, 48, 47% from three, rounding up. I'll give him the roundup, and then 78% from the line. And then tack on 7 rebounds, where he is a career 4.8 rebound type of guy. He's averaging 4 this season. And those rebounds have been absolutely huge for Rui and for this team. This team has needed Rui to step up in that capacity. And that's a great pick for starting your role.
Yeah, I saw a video recently from right before this stretch, a game where they were breaking down. I don't remember who we were facing, but it was late in the fourth quarter, and Rui almost got a rebound, but didn't hustle quite enough to get it and gave it up. And I believe the other team scored, and it was a crucial possession. They called a timeout after, and LeBron, Anthony Davis, I believe D'Lo, a lot of people got on Rui about that. Like you see it like visually in the footage. They got on him about that. And he has responded because ever since then, you can see he is hustling to get these rebounds. And he's not giving up easy. He's trying to get them. It's a conscious effort. And I love to see that. It's great to see teammates holding each other accountable and teammates responding from that and getting better from it.
Yes, absolutely. Tam says give it to Scorpio for stepping up. Yeah, absolutely. Sky, star in your role. Hell
Trevor
yeah.
texted me while I was on my flight. I was on my flight. I'm like, I'm there. I'm here. I'm ready. I'm in the nasty natty and I'm still doing it.
There we go. Oh, you guys are okay. I'll leave after we're done. I gotta talk to you. I forgot.
All
That's
right.
right. You go Rui. I'm gonna go Gabe Vincent then. Let's give our guy Gabe some love. I mean, we already talked about it. He's been really, really good defensively since he's came back. I don't want him to be a gunner, But I want him to, like, try to see if he could break his slump. And I like the fact that he got a little bit more aggressive tonight. He took four threes, hit one of them. I think the not the next possession down, but the, like, second to next possession after he hit the three. He comes right down, tries to hit another one. He ultimately doesn't hit it. But, like, I like the aggressiveness. If Graves an aggressive offensive player, that's another way that can kind of help him get back into a rhythm, is him being more aggressive. The minutes are starting to tick back up too now, where he played 19 minutes tonight. I think the highest before tonight was 15. So good to see Gabe starting to try to maybe get some confidence back.
Yeah, love that. Love that. Especially if we can get him playing like playoff Gabe, that's going to be big for us.
Yeah. All right. Let's see what else we got here. Don't forget, guys, we have the Master Lock of the Night coming up here. Make sure you guys get to think about what your Master Locks for the night are going to be. Shout out to Chris. Have you ever been in it, in the Master Lock?
No, thank goodness. Thank goodness. I have not.
Oh, man. Francisco said, Ham made me lose my parlay by leaving Rui on the bench for a long time. He just needed me one more point, one rebound, or assist. Oh, geez, that sucks. I'm convinced he must be fired. Yep, fire Darvin for costing our guy Francisco. Absolutely.
Put that on the paperwork when they give him his firing paperwork, whatever they call that. Pink slip.
Right, it's pink slip. I
pulled a Sean Davis. Firing paperwork.
You got a Seanism. There we go. About time. Not from me. Yeah. There we go. Yeah. Good grief. Yeah. On his pink slip.
Whoever's the second.
Yeah, there we go. It's going to read Cost Francisco Parlay. That's the reasoning. Oh, man. M Dread says, not impressed. We will be bounced in the play-in. SMH. Again, this was a frustrating night for sure. Ree with a super chat says, ugly win, but a win is a win. Denver loses now. Wolves can get the one seed. Good for us, but I also don't have faithfulness. We win two play-in games. Sky, let me ask you two questions here. One, how confident are you that if worst case scenario, or even if it is, I don't even want to say worst case, if the Lakers are 9-10, right? They are 9-10, meaning they have to win two games to get into the playoffs. How confident are you in the Lakers' ability to do that, to secure themselves a playoff spot? One, and two, who would you rather see round one, OKC or a potential matchup with Minnesota?
So, okay, to answer your first question, if we have to win two games, maybe 60-40, maybe a little bit more. Like, I feel confident in the sense of this team will ratchet things up. LeBron's going to go out, ball out. Anthony Davis is going to leave it all on the floor. Austin Reeves is going to go out. The rest, everybody else is going to fall in line and follow because they're not going to want to get bounced in the play-in. What makes me nervous is the teams around us having to be in a win or go home situation against a Golden State Warriors who can get hot and shoot 90% from three on 97 attempts, the Sacramento Kings or the Phoenix Suns, or like one of these types of teams where they're loaded with stars and they're tough and they can get hot in any moment. That's what makes me nervous. And to answer your second question, I would like to face Oklahoma City. I just think our size will be a big difference. I think Minnesota we can beat, but they have a lot of size over there. They're a very big team. And they have a bona fide superstar, just like Shea. They have Anthony Edwards. The difference is the Thunder is a much smaller team, and they're less experienced. They haven't been there quite yet. I don't think experience is going to matter as much for them because they're just so damn good. It won't. But like, yeah. I think the deeper you get into a series, I think, you know, we would have a chance to knock them out. But what do I know? I played them in 2K and I lost in seven games. So whatever. I lost the first three games.
We almost got the first 3-0 comeback though.
Yeah, man, I came back with three and then lost game seven. I was mad, bro. I was mad. I was raging, bro.
I agree with you ultimately. I do prefer the OKC matchup personally. because, I mean, styles make fights. And I, like you said, could they beat Minnesota? Yes, because I still just think right now Braun or even AD is still the best player in that series, right? And I think Minnesota's crunch time offense is really, really, like, poor. And that could also, like, favor the Lakers. But Minnesota's defense, when they're healthy, they just have length everywhere. So Braun is going to be facing Jaden McDaniels or maybe even Anthony Edwards or Kyle Anderson or things like that. Rudy Gobert is going to get AD all series, and they can maybe double him, use some of Cat size too. And then that's actually a series I'm probably the most worried about for a guy like a D'Lo, because they're probably going to throw Anthony Edwards on D'Lo, and I'm not so confident how that would pan out. So,
yeah.
And in an OKC series, OKC is a good defense, sure. But like you said, just the Lakers' size of Bron, Rui, AD as your front court, and hopefully you get a Vando back. It kind of gates the strengths of OKC's defense. And even though they have good defenders too, it's just not the same as it would be going up against a Minnesota. And can Chet really handle AD for a 7-game series? That's definitely something we would have to see. Both series would be really, really fun, though. I would be excited for both series.
Yeah, absolutely.
Trey says, send Darvin slow behind, and, you know, insert other word there, to the worst place a person could ever go, and send D'Angelo with them.
Place a person could ever go?
Right. You know you done messed up if somebody says full first name. Like, for example, like when I was growing up, my mom said first. No, for me, it was first, middle, and last name. If she said my middle name ever, you're in trouble. And, I mean, she said D'Angelo. No, I mean, we can't say D'Lo or Russell or something. We went D'Angelo.
D'Angelo.
D'Angelo, yeah, what are you doing?
Yeah, man. I don't really have much on that. Yeah, like I would love to know what the worst place you could ever send anybody. I guess maybe into the master lock.
Yeah, maybe. Ah, man. You know what? You set me up too good there. I was going to go into another super chat, but that was too good of a segue.
Master lock of the night.
Too good of a setup not to take it. Master lock of the night goes to the thing that was the most frustrating part of the game, and we put it into our good buddy Chris the Masterpiece Masters finishing maneuver. The master lock chat. What is the master lock? We got some master lock D'Lo.
Dylan master Brooks D'Lo. In 3, 2.
Hey, we got 1. It. There we go. Master lock, Trevor. Okay.
Trevor was at the game.
Trevor was at the game. It was covering. Trevor's still working. He was just not on the playback tonight. Master lock me. What did I do?
That's messed up.
What are we master locking me for?
Sean Davis is a saint.
Oh, man. All right, Sky, what are you putting in the master lock here tonight?
Super easy turnovers. Don't give the ball away, man. Don't give the ball. Above everything else, your shots might not always fall. You know, you might miss a defensive assignment or, you know, something, whatever. Like, but don't give the ball to the other team. That's just the most important thing. Don't just give them the ball.
Yeah, don't pull a Memphis Grizzlies and play quarterback and hand the ball off to LeBron with the game on the line. Don't do that.
It was a nice little shovel pass, too. It was a beautiful pass.
It was a great pass.
Yeah, it was nice. He should have got him an assist for that. Should have gave him an assist.
I'm going to master lock since you went turnovers. D'Lo, I kind of want to, but I feel like we've kind of talked enough about D'Angelo Russell. I'm going to go actually with Anthony Davis being spaced out as a just being used as a floor spacer late. And that is like a weird master lock, and it's a weird way of me wording it, but so I'm gonna reword it. Using AD as a floor spacer is getting my master lock here. To the point where I think Billy Mack on the call was getting livid at it. there's a point down the stretch, 3 minutes to go and beyond that, where the Lakers were playing Anthony Davis in the corner, specifically the left corner, and using him as a floor spacer. He even has to settle for a three because the shot clock's winding down. And Billy makes this point. I made the point, too, on our playback, playback.tv/LakersNation. Why is he being used as a floor spacer when and I know what the argument is going to be. The first response is going to be, well, it's to space the floor and to fully maximize the driving lane. That's not true at all, because if AD's in the corner and Sky's guarding it and Sky's man is Anthony Davis, Sky is not guarding Anthony Davis. He is worried about my LeBron James drive to the basket. So if you put Anthony Davis in the dunker spot, for example, even if you want to make him off ball, you put him in the dunker spot and I drive and Sky wants to step up to stop my drive, that is an easy lob or an easy dump off to AD. And even if I take a shot and I miss, AD is in a way more advantageous spot to grab an offensive rebound. That makes no sense. And they keep doing this. Stop making AD a floor spacer late in games and completely taking him out of the play. It's so bizarre and it pisses me off. Stop doing it.
That is a great master lock.
Good grief.
It's a great master lock.
Guys, make sure you guys hit smash the like button for me one more time. Lakers do
hit that like button.
Ultimately get the win tonight. Check the scores around the league one more time. The Pelicans are up 13, third quarter just started.
Okay.
And the Suns are down one in the middle of the second quarter right now. Neither team really scoring well right now. It's in the 30s in that game. Imagine, man, like back in 2010, we said it's like 37-36 in the middle of the second quarter. That's a high-scoring affair.
Yeah. Yeah, I was talking to a friend not that long ago, and I was complaining about Darvin and talking about how he just doesn't call timeouts to stop runs and yada yada, you know, the same stuff we always talk about. And he was just like, yeah, you know, Phil Jackson would kind of not call timeouts. He would just kind of let his teams figure it out. I was like, yeah, back when the ending score of a game was 67 to 65, like, sure, you could do that. Now they're dropping 60 points in a quarter. Like,
dog, what was the final score of that Boston game 7? No, actually, I think game 6 of that series. Like, whoever lost, I want to say L.A. lost game 6 in 2010. They scored, like, 66 points.
Yeah. That was an ugly series.
Yeah. And then game 7, it was 83-79. So, like, yeah, like, sure, you can have. I'm going to let you ride it out because nobody's going to score.
Nobody's scoring. Like, they went on a big run. 6-0. like you don't have to call a timeout. You're fine. Like
6-0 in a span of 5 minutes.
Yeah, in a span of 5 minutes.
BC fact checks. We appreciate it, actually. 89-67 was that game 6 score. And LA did hold them under 70 points. BC, was that game? Is that game 2? What game was it that LA held them under 70? I'm trying to recall. I want to say it was like earlier on in the series.
That is crazy to even think about now.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, like 67 points for four quarters?
In a full NBA basketball game, 67 points.
That is
GG Jackson dang near scored half that himself tonight.
Yeah. Okay, wait. Okay, my bad. I had it flipped. So the 89-67 was Lakers winning game 6. I apologize. My memory is messed up. I thought LA was up 3-2 heading into game 6, and they lost game 6 leading into game 7. I had it flipped. That's my apologies.
That's all right.
I'm about to get master locked in hateful messages on Twitter. Now, look at this real Laker fan. Doesn't even remember.
This is funny. This is the most angry Lakers fans have been since with a victory. And I understand it. So justifiably so. But yeah, we've got some angry super chats today.
Well, here's another one. M Dread says 70 points from our stars just to beat a D League team. SMH, jeez,
my man said D League team.
I know we're going
way back.
The Lakers winning this game set the league back like a decade.
That's great.
Oh man, super chat here says no words for this effort against the YMCA Griffin. I gotta admit, these are some creative super chats.
This is good. This is good.
Oh, man. Mom Mentality says, gotta play better than this versus the Pels or we're cooked. Yep. Gotta have a better effort come Sunday.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
Let's get to a couple more here. X says, can somebody please help Bron and AD? I legitimately thought Austin was on his way to a good game, and then Austin got into foul trouble. That kind of set him back. Rui was playing well, and he just kind of stopped getting minutes, which was bizarre.
Yeah, not having Austin did hurt us. We have to keep let's not forget that we did, Austin played very limited minutes because of the foul trouble, and he was having a good game, and he does usually kill the Grizzlies. So
yeah,
that definitely had an effect.
Yeah. BC responds that it was 2004 NBA Finals where the Pistons held the Lakers under 70. Yeah, they did that a couple times, right? Game three for sure. Did you ever even – yes, we checked the standings already. I mean, I can pull them back up one more time if it's super important. Sky, apparently you look like Darvin Ham. That's what somebody in the chat just said. I just came across
really?
The screen. Really? I don't think so.
Is it just because I have my hands in my pockets or
bald black guy with the beard is Darvin Ham?
I can see that. I feel like I look younger than Darvin Ham, but maybe I don't. It is what it is. I could be Darvin.
So here's the update on the standings for anybody that's just now joining us. Lakers are currently the eighth seed, but that is solely dependent on the Kings and the Warriors result. The Lakers do not control their own destiny right now. And some bad news, the third quarter Warriors have arrived. They were down, 16 at halftime. They are now down 5. A quick 18-9 run to start off the quarter. So that's definitely not what we wanted to see. And the Kings are up 5 now with the first half winding down. So that is not what we wanted to see. If the Lakers went out, meaning they beat the Pelicans on Sunday, and the Kings and the Warriors lose tonight, the Lakers will be the 8th seed. Or even if, Lakers win on Sunday with a Kings and Warriors loss, winning, losing. They won of their final two games. Both of them have to lose. The Lakers are locked into the 8th seed. Phoenix, technically is still a possibility, but you almost don't even want Phoenix to lose to Sacramento tonight, because if Phoenix loses to Sacramento, that means we need Sacramento to lose to Portland on Sunday, which, again, how likely is that? So that's why don't even worry about the 7. Just hope that Phoenix can beat Sacramento tonight. That's why we are rooting for the Kings tonight. I'm sorry, for the Suns tonight. Excuse me.
For the Suns. Absolutely. Absolutely.
And Suns are now up. I'm sorry, Kings are now up 8. Let's get to a couple more Super Chats, and the rest of them Trevor will get to on a separate show. Let's see.
Yeah, because I like when Trevor answers them, because Trevor is the most composed person I've ever seen in my life. He'll get super chats, and they'll be like, I hate this team so much. AD is so lazy. LeBron is washed. Austin Reeves sucks. I hate D'Lo. Get rid of him. I hate this team. Ah! And Trevor will be like, I understand your frustration. I understand your frustration. He's just so calm, but he's just, I understand your frustration. This is really tough right now. And it's like, man, he is so composed, man. He should be a therapist.
This is a really tough time for the fan base right now. And I understand your anger. I actually agree with you, and I want to join you. But
he can make some more, he can make money on the side being a therapist to Lakers fans in the off seasons. Like, we signed Patrick Beverly again. Why? Laying on the couch and Trevor's just sitting there next to them.
Well, so this is what happens when money is involved with NBA players. And I'm sorry that they did this to you. I can't do anything about it, but sucks.
Very calm. Very cool.
Very calm.
He's a cool cat. All right. Sorry. Get back to it.
No, you're good.
This is what happens when you have me on the show. I go off the rails all the time. Sorry. Go.
Yeah. Oh, no. It's awesome. One more. Let's do one more super chat here. Lil Black says, let's just take this win, guys. Sure, it was frustrating, but let's just take the win in and keep on grinding and winning and hopeless. Fully grind all the way to champions. That is a great way to be optimistic to end off the show. Appreciate the super chat there. And appreciate everybody that hopped in and joined us here. Again, the leftover super chats, there are a few more left. We'll get sent over to Trevor. Trevor will cover them on a pod that will drop tomorrow, or that will release tomorrow, presumably. Trevor will cover the remaining super chats tomorrow's show. Sky, thank you so much, bro, for hopping on with me. This is a ton of fun. Always love talking ball with you.
My pleasure, man. I'm excited. Let's get this win on Sunday, and let's roll into the playoffs after we take care of business in the play-in.
Absolutely. Guys, go Phoenix. For tonight only, felt really weird saying that, but remember, we want a Phoenix win, and we want a New Orleans win for tonight, so let's continue to root for that. But all right, guys, Lakers back in action Sunday against the Pelicans, and we will find out the fate of this Lakers team and their play-in tournament. What it's going to look like for them. But thank you guys so much for tuning in here to LakersNation.com postgame show. Leave a like and subscribe to the channel. Till next time, everybody. See ya. Stay safe and go Lake Show. Peace out.